Here we take a look at the electrolysis of copper to sulphate solution. The solution, as you can see, is blue. This here is copper sulphate solution. And I'm going to use this device here for my copper electrodes. So there you can see my copper electrodes as they are at the start. Now, looking at the diagram here, I'm going to use 9 volts direct current. I've placed the, in this case, this is the an example where we're using electrodes that do get involved in the electrolysis process. They are not inert in this situation. We have copper electrodes dipping into a solution of copper sulfate. And on the left here, this is the electrode connected to the positive terminal, so that's the anode. And over here, this is the cathode. Both electrodes are made of copper. Let's take a look at the table to see what happens. And when the electricity begins to flow, the table presents what happens here. Try and put it up the right way. There we go. Now, in a solution, an aqueous solution of copper sulfate, you mustn't forget that the solvent, water, provides ions as well as the copper sulfate. In water, something like about a 1 in a million water molecules breaks up or dissociates to produce a hydrogen ion and a hydroxide ion. The hydroxide ion OH minus and the hydrogen ion H plus. So while it's quite obvious that the copper sulfate is providing the copper ions and the sulfate ions, do keep in mind the hydroxide ions and hydrogen ions coming from the water itself. Remember that electrolysis acts like a bully, a double bully. The electricity pulls and pushes electrons, pulls electrons from this side, the anode, doesn't care whether it gets them from the hydroxide ions or the sulfate ions. Neither of these ions want to give up electrons, but one will be forced to do so, at least in normal circumstances. Over here at the cathode, neither of these want to gain electrons, but one of them will be forced to gain electrons. Electrolysis is a very high energy process, and it has the energy required to pull electrons off ions that don't want to give them up, and push them onto ions that don't want to give, want to accept them. Seems perhaps a pointless exercise, but it isn't, because we're converting copper sulfate into a much more useful form, in that we're about to produce copper from copper sulfate. Now, in this particular case, when it comes to these ions, which one gets discharged, the answer is neither. And the reason that neither get discharged is that there is another source of electrons. And in this particular case, that source is quite happy to give the electrons up, and that source is the copper. Copper is quite happy to give up electrons and become copper ions. So in this particular case, if we look back at the diagram, at this electrode here, the source of electrons, the battery wants to pull electrons, doesn't care where it gets them from. Will it be the hydroxide ions or the sulfate ions that are attracted to the positive electrode? No. It'll get them from the copper atoms that make up the anode. They, as you see here, undergo oxidation. Copper atoms give up 2 electrons each and create copper ions. Now, while copper atoms are insoluble in water, copper ions here are soluble, and as a result, we expect to see this electrode on the left, the anode, get smaller in size. So neither of the negative ions get discharged. It is the copper that makes up the anode that is the source of electrons that get pulled by the power source around here and then get pushed out towards here. And these electrons come round and build up on the cathode, making it negative. Now here we have both copper ions from the copper sulfate, but also the hydrogen ions from the water are attracted to the cathode here. Which one of these is going to be discharged? Which one's going to be forced to accept electrons? Well, in this case, if you think of your reactivity series, copper is actually less reactive than hydrogen. We say it's less electropositive. So in this particular case, because copper is less electropositive than hydrogen, it has less ability to remain positive as the Cu2 plus ion, and it ends up being discharged. And what happens here is the exact opposite of what happens here. The copper ions, which get attracted in here, because they're positive and this electrode is negative, imagine them coming in and accepting electrons, two each, and they change from ions in solution into copper atoms. While these are soluble, the ions, these are insoluble, and as a result they deposit onto this electrode. So one has an after diagram here as well. This would be the after diagram. This is going to wear away because as the power source here is pulling electrons, and it's doing so by getting them from the copper atoms, turning into copper ions. And as a result, we get copper atoms which are insoluble turning into copper ions which are soluble, and they go into solution. The electrons move through the circuit, build up on the cathode. Copper ions are attracted in here, accept electrons, they are reduced, forming copper atoms which are insoluble, so they deposit on top of the cathode and the cathode gets bigger. Again, you should pause and copy this down. And if you're ready, we can try to demonstrate this process. So if I take in a small beaker here, I'm going to pour some solution onto this. Maybe bring this in a little bit closer. Now, I'll pour some copper sulfate solution into that beaker. Now I have my electrodes here, as you see. We'll immerse those into the electrolyte. These are copper electrodes. And I now have a circuit here, a power pack, and I'll connect up, to be consistent, I'm going to connect the red lead, which is the positive lead, to the left hand side, and then the black lead coming across to the other side, making sure these crocodile clips don't touch and short the circuit. And we're ready to go. I've got a bulb in the circuit here as well, so we can see if the current is actually flowing. And I'm going to switch the power pack on now. You can see the solution is an excellent conductor. The bulb lights up immediately. I have to have shorted that out, so I'm going to remove the bulb. We now have the current flowing here. We let it go for a moment or two there, see what happens. Now I did one of these earlier, and I'll show you what the result was. As I show it now to you on camera, the electrodes had been the same length, and this is what I've got now. This is what I got after about 2 hours. You can see that the left-hand electrode, in fact, has worn away at the bottom. They were immersed at about this depth here, and this is completely dissolved away. It won't be clear, but this here has thickened up the right hand electrode, the negative electrode, the cathode. Copper has deposited up and it has got heavier. I think you can see that perhaps it has got shinier, and you can indeed see what looks like pure copper has been deposited there. This has been running now for probably a minute or two. You can move it to see if there's any noticeable change here. And I do think you see, certainly see a noticeable change there. If I switch it off momentarily, and if I rub this here with my finger, you can begin to see a deposit of copper forming there. Fresh copper is forming on the right hand electrode, the cathode. So we'll just take that out again, remind you of the key diagrams. We had that one. Then we had the after diagram. I want to pause that. And then we also had the table of results. A quick summary. Electricity acts as a bully. It's pulling electrons from one side, the anode, and pushing them out to the other side, the cathode. Think of the electricity as pulling electrons. It doesn't matter where it's getting them from. It could take them from the hydroxide ions or the sulfate ions, neither of which want to give them up. If we were using inert graphite electrodes, I can tell you that it would be the hydroxide ions that give up the electrons. But in this particular case, instead of getting them from the hydroxide or the sulfate, which don't want to give electrons up, it gets them from the copper electrode itself, the anode. It's quite happy to change from copper atoms into copper ions, and in so do giving, it gives up the electrons that are being pulled towards the battery. Those very same electrons are pushed over to the cathode. Now at the cathode, the negative electrode, we have the copper ions and the copper sulfate, and the hydrogen ions from the water. In this particular case, copper is less electropositive, slower in the reactivity series than hydrogen. They get discharged, they are forced to accept electrons, and those ions which are soluble accept electrons and form insoluble copper atoms which deposit onto the cathode, and the cathode gets bigger. Now this method is used in the electrolytic refining of copper. In the electrolytic refining of copper, we put the impure blister copper, which comes from industry, we use it to make the anode, and we use pure copper to make the cathode. We dip those into copper sulfate, pass electricity through the circuit. The blister copper making up the anode, this dissolves away, forming copper ions, and those copper ions migrate across through the electrolyte over to the cathode, where they are then discharged, changing from copper ions, Cu2 plus, into insoluble copper atoms. And so when the process is ended, this is worn away and this has got bigger, and only the copper has moved over here. There are some iron ions present in the impure blister copper obtained in industry. Iron will also enter in here as ions. Now, will it be the iron ions or the copper ions that are discharged? Well, in this case, iron is more electropositive and has the ability, a greater ability, to remain positive as positive ions. So the iron ions will go into solution but will not be discharged over here. We also get some precious metals in the blister copper, and they usually deposit at the bottom here as a sludge. And indeed, that sludge can be taken out and those precious metals extracted from the sludge as a byproduct of the process. That is called the electrolytic refining of copper. And that completes our electrolysis here.